just a good old boy, never meaning no harm. Beats all you never saw, been in trouble with the law since a teenage boy. Straightening the curve, yeah, flattening the hill. Someday the mountain might get a little long and weird. Making their way the only way they know how. That's just a little bit more than the law will allow.
We took a wrong turn coming out of Hazzard County
because
it looks like we're in Manhattan. But we are here to bust up a few preconceptions anyways.
Yeah, you know, people think that country music is just big hair, big boobs, and rhinestones.
Well, where's the rhinestones?
But if you listen to the words, it's really, it's universal.
Yeah, I mean, who hasn't shot a man in Reno just to watch him die? Johnny Cash.
I got ya.
Yeah. Okay. What we're trying to say is that country music is kind of like, but it's kind of like the General Lee. I mean, it is uniquely American, but there is something in it for everybody.
That's right.
Well, I've always felt that country music was the white man's rhythm and blues.
Music that comes from the heart.
It's working man's music.
It's the rural folk music of America.
It's the biggest music in the world.
It's whatever you think it is.
Fair enough, but where did it all begin? Over to our resident anthropologist.
Most of our country music, which we also call mountain music where I grew up, was a combination of the Appalachian sound, which came from the old world of England and Ireland and a lot of the Scottish music.
Back in the 19th century, European folk and fiddles collided with African America's guitars, banjos, and blues. Country, the soul music of white working class America, was born. Live radio and TV broadcasts from Nashville's Ryman Auditorium, which was known as the Grand Ole Opry, took country national in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s.
Within my heart lies a melody.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling round the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since. I don't know when I'm stuck in Folsom Prison.
And from there, the sleepy Tennessee town became Music City, creating its own industry, its own sound, and its own hairstyles.
Hey, if you happen to see the most beautiful girl that walked out on me,
well, it's knowing that your door's always open and your path is free to walk.
I remember we outsold the Beatles in 1969. So I've heard.
But there were those that rebelled, the so-called country outlaws of the 70s.
Somebody told me when I came to Nashville, son, you finally got it made as I was crawling.
But some rebels wanted to go mainstream and global.
Here I was 36, 37 years old. And I still had long hair down to my shoulder and earrings in my ears, and I thought, you know, I can't be young anymore. We were doing country songs that would sell pop. After you get your momentum, you do pop songs that sell country.
Items in the street, that is what we are. No one
excuse me, Kitty.
How can we be wrong? Sail away with me.
It's from Nashville. But it really wants to be rock and roll. It wants to be stadium rock. It wants to be M.O.R.
What can he mean? Anyway, after the worldwide hits of the 70s and 80s, the soft country rock of the 90s has scaled unimaginable heights. All All the same, forget over a century of history and the occasional high wire act, country's still boring, right? Wrong.
Once you scratch the surface of country music and the scar opens and the blood pours out and the stuff that comes out.
Tonight we've got 32 marriages, almost as many divorces, 13 funerals, myriad addictions and self-destruction, and even the odd kidnapping. Oh, and some great music. Stand by for 10 acts who've enjoyed at least some UK chart success but are ranked according to US sales. Buckle up, it's going to be a wild ride.
You should never trust anyone who doesn't listen to country music.
All right, it's time to get this show on the road. Now, in the true spirit of Hazzard County decorum, I believe that ladies should go first. Lady Catherine?
Well, thank you, sweetie.
Well, you're welcome.
And we're going to start with a lady who had a great career,
yeah,
but a terrible life. I mean, we're talking the kind of life that you see on daytime television or in a country music song.
Right.
Come to think of it.
Watch.
They're justified and they're ancient and they like to roam the land.
It's a long way from Moo Moo Land to the backwoods of Mississippi, where for a teenage girl from a poor family, there was only one way out, an early marriage.
And I can't say that it wasn't better for a while than being on the farm. It was. But then time passed and things got worse because the marriage wasn't working.
Tammy Wynette decided she was going to become a country singer by driving into Nashville with four children in the car, had left her husband, and I think she had the pram on, or a pram on the roof of the car.
Tammy is a true country artist, you know. She was like a beautician who came to Nashville and had the Cinderella story, you know.
I don't a playhouse.
Singing beautician Tammy Wynette divorced her first husband to seek fame and fortune in Nashville. Once she met local big wheel Billy Sherrill, it wasn't long in coming. Together, they recorded some of country's greatest standards.
The way it's done, I don't want a playhouse.
Tammy and Billy went upstairs to Billy's office and came back about 10 minutes later with the song, Stand By Your Man. It was cut instantly and was on the street in 3 days and was a monster record.
After all, he's just a man.
Tammy would say, nowhere does it say be a servant to your man, but you have to stand by your man. So she was just very much a product of her environment and the way that she grew up as a Southern woman.
Tammy didn't always stand by and take it, and when things got bad with second husband Don Chattel, there was a knight in shining armor with hair like a helmet standing by to help.
And Joan says, don't talk about her like that. And Don says, why? She's my wife. And he said, because I love her.
Step by step, we walk the road together.
Divorce number two, husband number three. Tammy's idol, country legend George Jones. As country's first couple, they sang together and had a daughter together, called, logically enough, Georgette. But George drank alone.
How did she say that? He nipped too much, and I nagged too much. So yes, it was public knowledge that his drinking was a major part of their problem.
The whole neighborhood knows Jones is home drunk again.
She was also quick to take responsibility in not knowing about an alcoholic, not knowing how to deal with it.
Lord, if drinking don't kill me, Tammy's memory will.
So, divorce number three, and after spending 44 days married to an estate agent, Tammy finally found true love on her own back porch with longtime friend George Ritchie.
Billy Sherrill said we wouldn't when we got married. That was his one statement. He said, there'll be no more sad songs written or no more happy songs either, but especially sad songs. He said, you'll never write again.
Wish that I was on a rocky top down in Tennessee hills.
You paid top dollar if you wanted Tammy Wynette. You paid for hair and makeup, you paid for limousines, you paid for private planes, you paid through the nose if you wanted Tammy Wynette for something.
Of course, Tammy made the occasional exception for the old and infirm.
He's just a man.
But country's first lady was hiding terrible health problems.
She could get a standing ovation, and yet off stage she could barely talk sometimes. Being on stage was what kept Tammy alive in a lot of ways.
Thank you.
Did Tammy ever have any luck? She had 17 stomach ops, a prescription drug addiction, and was even kidnapped for a few hours by a thief who broke into her car. Her career was suffering as well.
So I thought, what is there to lose? Let's go cut a pop hit. They thought I had gone totally insane.
At one point, I remember Tammy saying, where is Moo Moo Land? I mean, what is this about?
They're justified, and they're ancient, and they drive an ice cream van.
They're justified. Justified and Ancient was number one in 19 countries and was Tammy's last hit. In April 1998, she finally succumbed to long-term health problems and died at just 55.
And those songs, Stand By Your Man and D-I-V-O-R-C-E, they will be country standards there forever, you know. When you think of those are her songs forever.
Stand by your man and show the world you love him. Keep giving hope.
Most people say it could be a wonderful soap opera. I'm sure it could, but to me it's just my life.
You know, surfing and country music don't go together all that well. I mean, just imagine trying to hang 10 wearing a pair of these cowboy boots. And you know what? It's darn near impossible to keep your hat on, too, which makes this next artist all the more unique.
Well, East Coast girls are hit by really dig those styles they wear.
No, the Beach Boys aren't at number 9, but one of their former members is. Back then, he was just a young session guitarist from Arkansas.
A gang of about 12, 14 musicians called the Wrecking Crew, and we virtually played all the Dean Martin albums, the Frank Sinatra stuff, Beach Boys, Jan and Dean. It was just a marvelous, marvelous variety that I got to play. I don't remember not having a guitar in my hand, you know, because Daddy had bought one from, he had ordered it from a, you know, a retail catalog. I think he paid $7 for it or something. You know, just go. Just play, I just wanted to play fast as I could. When I was with the Beach Boys, playing bass and singing with them for a while.
After becoming country's first and only surf star, it was time for Glenn to ride his own wave.
I kind of got oriented to a group, and when I had to step out and be Glenn Campbell, I was so nervous.
Glenn's solo career really took off when he heard a song written by this man, composer Jimmy Webb. And it produced his first really big hit.
By the time I get to Phoenix, you'll be rising. And when he said, by the time I make Albuquerque, she'll be sleeping. And or working.
By
by the time I get to Phoenix, she'll be rising.
Jimmy Webb is a magnificent poet. He's a magnificent lyricist, and the chord progressions are just, he just hears them differently. He's like Burt Bacharach and Hal David.
I am a lineman for the county, and I drive the main road, searching in the sun for another overload. I hear you singing in the wire.
And it's funny, I'd go cut my little country stuff, and I'd come and we'd compare records, and I'd play mine, and I'd have steel guitar and a couple of guitars and a few strings, and Glenn would play Wichita Lineman, which had 80 strings, and I'd go, well, never mind, let's listen to yours for a while. I mean, mine sounded so simple by comparison, you know.
And here we stand in a box of sand. Where's the playground, Susie?
Glenn had gone global. At one stage, he was outselling the Beatles and sharing the silver screen with the Duke. But country's best-looking drama student had a far from easy time with his producer. Fortunately, he dealt with it in a mature and adult manner.
Henry Hathaway said, we're going to kill you off at the end of the movie, you know. And I said, I want to be killed off at the end of the movie. Anyway, I wish I hadn't went along with it now, because I didn't have to do it. You know, I said, I'm not going to die. I can do whatever I want to. But I didn't, because my manager at the time,
no, boy, you do what Hal Wallace and Hathaway want you to do.
Well, I didn't want to be killed off in True Grit.
Dwindling record sales meant Glenn's music career was in danger of an early exit as well. It was saved by one song.
I lived that. I went through the Rhinestone Cowboy. That whole song, you know. It's the way I was before when I was struggling on the road. I was so happy that Rhinestone Cowboy made it, because it revitalized the record career.
But privately, things weren't going well. Three wives had come and gone, and things hit rock bottom after a disastrous fling with country starlet Tanya Tucker and his new best friend, Charlie.
The cocaine, that was a tough trip. It's a killer drug. You know.
The rhinestoned cowboy needed a miracle, so he asked for one.
And I just kind of lay there for about 6 hours on a couch and praying, Lord, deliver me from this. And I swear I'll never do it again.
Someday and some way you realize that you.
Born-again Campbell left the Sodom of L.A. behind, and by the time Glenn got back to Phoenix, where he still lives today, there was a fourth wife, a new family, and a second chance.
He came down, we got married, and started raising a family, and I've just been so blessed. To know the truth of where you're going, where you come from, I'm happier than I've ever been in my life, and more content.
It's just a matter of time.
You know, country music's kind of like the movies. For every guy in a white hat, you got a man in black. And the guy at number 8 is the genuine article.
When he walks in a room, it's almost like he has the presence of a king.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Time was when Johnny Cash, country's legendary man in black, was just a boy in dungarees, and then the youth in white.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine.
I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds, because you're mine. I walk the line.
In the mid-50s, Johnny Cash had a string of hits with the legendary Sun Records, recording and touring with fellow hopefuls like Porter Wagoner, Jerry Lee Lewis, and some bloke called Presley.
Elvis said, "Will you guys ride with me today?" And he had his pink Cadillac. And had it parked in the garage there, and the guy brought it around. And Johnny Cash and I were standing there waiting for him. He said, "I'm not riding in that car." Cash said this to him. He said, "Why not?" He said, "That's a queermobile, man." He said, "I ain't riding that car at all. I ain't riding nowhere in it." He got his own car and drove it. I got in and rode with it. I thought it was great, man. But that shows you sort of how naive that three country boys were.
And the naivety went beyond confused sexual politics. A grueling schedule meant Johnny needed a pick-me-up. He was soon addicted to the pills he was popping, and even spent a day in a Mexican jail on possession charges.
I got a cow that went dry and a hen that won't lay. Big stack of bills that get bigger each day. The county will haul my belongings away.
Johnny Cash was the sexiest man I've ever seen in my life. I didn't know what sex appeal was until I saw Johnny Cash at that time. He was on drugs and he was all spastic and hyper, and it was so sexy.
Now I tossed a weeping willow how to cry. And I showed the clouds how to cover.
He says, "You know, I had a dream." I said, "Yes." "I dreamt that I heard the ring of fire with Mexican trumpets."
The taste of love is sweet.
Well, he was taking those amphetamines back then, and we thought he was a little high. So we said, "Oh, great idea, good idea, yeah, hey."
But the fire was wild. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire.
The classics kept coming, but Cash was still an addict. In the end, marriage to his longtime performing partner June Carter saved him. She just kept throwing the pills away until Johnny wasn't hooked anymore.
Just poor people, that's all we were, trying to make a
I learned the hard way about drugs. I didn't really, not as hard as I could have learned, I guess, because I courted death with it. I just, for a long time, I took my chances and tried, I guess, a little bit of everything there was to try.
So the liberal conscience of country was clean. Good news for the convicts who attended those legendary prison concerts.
Took me to St. Louis, later on down the river. A freighter said she's been here, but she's gone, boy, she's gone. I found a train.
He was a rebel, and they identified with him. He was successful, and they didn't give a shit if he had any talent or not. They liked him personally because he had enough nerve to get up there, and he had enough sincerity to come out there on a New Year's Day and play music for those damned old men, you know. He's an asshole doing time, and everybody appreciated it.
And away from the liberal causes, John enjoys a bloody good laugh.
Watch her, she might kick if you hit her back there. Don't, Roseanne, watch it, Roseanne.
Watch it, Roseanne.
Walk behind her, honey, she might kick. I'm sorry.
Well, I knew that snake was my own sweet dad from a worn-out picture that my mother had had. I knew that scar on his cheek and his evil eye. He was big and bent and gray and old, and I looked at him, blood ran cold. I said, "My name is Sue. How do you do? Why do you want to die?"
The thing I learned about from Johnny Cash is that he didn't compromise what he believed in. Integrity. He never compromised his integrity, hardly ever.
I'd love to wear a rainbow every day.
to tell the world that everything's okay. But maybe I can carry off a little darkness on my back till things are brighter. I'm the man in black.
Between heaven and hell, a teardrop fell in the deep crimson dew. The tree of life grew.
Today, in his late 60s, Cash is fighting serious illness. But remember, the man in black has bounced back before.
As long as I'm able to work, I'm going to keep singing. I love it.
You know, country music can be very deceptive. It makes people think that they can just wander into a studio, sing a song, and have a hit. Now take television personalities, for example. Believe me, by the time you are finished watching this next clip, you're going to be hoping and praying for a commercial break. Watch this. Very serious.
Some broken hearts never mend.
Kojak Goes Country. Yes, it's a clearly disorientated Telly Savalas, a Greek-American TV cop, singing a country song on German television. It all makes a horrible kind of sense. Disco met country when Dallas Devil Munchkin Charlene Tilton carved out a Nashville career, a move which clearly alarmed the Bee Gees. No further comment on this one. We'd need him back for part two. It's all enough to drive you to drink. Prost.
Now, before the break, we were taking a look at the great Johnny Cash. And if he's country's Prince of Darkness, this next guy is more like the Milky Bar Kid.
The single-engine plane with one person on board crashed into the sea near Monterey in Northern California shortly after it had taken off. According to relatives, the pilot was John Denver. One said he loved flying, he died doing something he loved.
There must have been something inherently wrong, in my opinion, with something in that airplane, because John was a magnificent pilot. He flew all kinds of aircraft.
Short-sighted John Deutschendorf grew up on air bases around the world. His love of flying came from his father, a war hero. His love of the great outdoors came from his grandmother's farm in Oklahoma. Once he became John Denver, he learned his trade in the folk clubs of 60s California. This didn't go down well in the capital of country.
Because he was singing about country things, he, you know, was credited as a country musician. But the reality is that I don't think he had much impact with Nashville at all.
My life went to roll.
John said that his best and truest friend was the outdoors. And I really believe that. It's the place I think that John was the most at home.
He was the most important artist of that particular period. In 1975, he was the country music artist of the year with songs like Back Home Again and Take Me Home Country Roads. He won every award in 1975.
Live on communication satellite from Perth, Australia. John?
This is very pleasing to me, and I thank you very much. And for two reasons, especially, I'm very pleased to have the opportunity of of acknowledging all of you in country and western music. I was raised on country and western music. It is a part of my whole life.
Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. Woo!
John just decided he didn't want to be categorized and try to avoid the problems of country. At one point he said, you know, I wish I had the Domingo voice. I wouldn't mind being called an opera singer.
You know, I guess he was more of a California deal than a Nashville deal. You know, and I think that was reflective of the different time in country music where, you know, Olivia Newton-John was also a country artist.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River.
After the horror of an Olivia Newton-John cover, John became a bit of a soft rocker as the mega sales of the 70s dried up. Still, the nicest man in pop was more concerned with his work for charity, and he did like to sing about it.
Take it away from the hands of the poor. Tell me, what are we making weapons for?
John just seemed to have boundless energy and dedication to all these causes. He cared very deeply about children and about hunger. This was something that really haunted him.
John Denver died in 1997, and despite all the huge hits and good works, he's probably still best remembered for one very personal song.
You fill up my senses like a night in forest.
We had a falling out, like we had some sort of disagreement, and then had made up. And John, he was leaving to go skiing, and he said, look, he said, and it was a snowy day, and he said, I'm just going to go up and take a few runs, and I'll be back. And he came back within an hour and a half, and he had gotten on the chairlift, and he sat down, and he wrote the song, Bam.
Let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter.
People ask me about John writing all these songs for me. They're about me, and they're about our life together. But then ultimately, they're about John's ability to love.
Like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain.
When he died, I feel like a part of me died, part of my history. And it's like I feel incredibly grateful. The fact that John came into my life. I mean, I almost can't put words to how grateful I am. And I just can't believe he's not here.
Like a sleepy blue ocean, you fill up my senses. Come fill me again.
Well, if John Denver crossed over, I guess you could say the next act kind of stuck out. And you know what? If she had a dollar for every time she had to hear that line, she'd be a millionaireess. Come to think of it, she has. She is.
So she's certainly the queen of country music, and also carries the title of the best chest in the West.
Here I sit, all alone.
If you ask anybody Dolly Parton, they'll say tits.
She got big tits. And I used to think, well, call me a pervert, but I actually like Dolly Parton for her voice.
Fantastic words, very perceptive songs, great melodies. What else do you want?
Now, I know I look like a dumb blonde. In fact, that was the name of my very first hit record on Monument Records. I didn't write it. It was a song written by Curly Putman. But it says, just because I'm blonde, don't think I'm dumb, because this dumb blonde ain't nobody's fool.
Don't try to pry your way out of this. Don't try to lie, or I'll catch you in.
Yes, this dumb blonde has sold over 50 million records worldwide, is a film star, owns a $100 million media empire, and, naturally enough, has her very own theme park. All a long way from this shack in Locust Ridge, Tennessee, where the precocious young blonde grew up.
When I was little, I was making songs before I could write them down. I was making them up, and my mama was fascinated with how I could rhyme words, and she used to write them down. And I would sing them to my family, mostly, and the chickens and the ducks and the pigs and the dogs.
The young songwriter's first chance to reach a wider audience came on a local radio show.
When I finished my little song, oh, I got this huge round of applause. I got an encore. I didn't even know what that word meant. It just meant I had to sing it again. I remember when we left the radio station that day, we were walking toward my Uncle Bill's car, and I remember feeling so proud, and I said, I'm going to be a big star, don't you think? They really liked me, don't you think? And it was like he said, yeah, I think you are.
Next stop, Nashville.
Graduated on a Friday night in 1964. I'd been packed and ready to go for years. And I didn't have anything to bring. I had all my matching luggage, three paper bags from the same grocery store. And I thought I was just going to get off the bus and be a star. A couple of years later, I was still crying and still hungry and still, you know, I never thought I'd ever go home. When I left, I told my mom, I'll come back when I'm a star.
Pretty Miss Dolly Parton.
Dolly finally got her break with country TV star Porter Wagoner.
Hey, man, she got big boobs. Why, that's the reason you hired her. Don't tell me no that had nothing to do with it at all.
Dolly and Porter were a huge success, but one half of the duet had bigger plans.
It was one of those love-hate relationships. I was doing all the love and he was doing all the hate.
She wanted to be on her own, and she wanted to be the boss. You can't be the boss when I'm writing out the checks. I'm going to be the boss.
If I should stay, I'd only be in your way. So I'll go, but I'll think of you each step of the way, and I'll always love you. And I hope life treats you kind, and I hope you have all you ever dreamed of. I wish you joy and happiness, and above all this, I wish you love, but I'm out of here. And I will love. Of course, last year when Whitney Houston did I Will Always Love You, I bought the bank. And bless her heart.
Solo, Dolly became a superstar.
Jolene, Jolene, I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. He'll come again. And looking better than a body has a right to. Heartbreaker, I wish I'd seen. I just know it! Working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living. Really getting by. Well, it's all taking and no giving.
And just when you thought she couldn't get any bigger, she did. After Nashville, Dolly conquered Hollywood as well.
Tell us, what is it like to work with Burt Reynolds?
Well, it's bad. It really is. We start at 5 o'clock in the morning rehearsing the kissing scenes, and then after lunch, we do a dress rehearsal for the kissing scenes, and then about 3 to 5, we film the kissing scenes, and then we have to hang around till midnight sometimes doing retakes, and I just think I'm just going on strike.
Dolly's private life is far less obvious. She's been married to Carl Dean for over 30 years, but nobody knows what he looks like. Dolly's been just as low-key on the business front. And like other country stars, she's held on to her fortune and avoided the excess.
I'm going to be who I am. I'm not going to fry my brains, you know, with drugs and alcohol and ruin my life and my career. Not to say that I'm a goody-goody, and I've done my share of things, but I've never... I'm too stingy to buy drugs anyway. You know, it's like, ain't no way I'm going to blow my money on that. You know, I'd rather buy cheap wigs and, you know, just a bunch of patty bras or something.
Why don't the women sing honky-tonk songs?
Ladies and gentlemen, Dolly Parton, 53 years old, Nashville superstar through and through, songwriter extraordinaire, and a bit of a rebel to boot.
I was always true to myself. I think you always have to be. And anything I've ever done, it's because I wanted to do it, not because I thought I needed to do it to fit in. Because I was sort of like Willie and Waylon. If they didn't like the way I was, they could kiss my country ass.
Hey, you know what? We've got more female country artists on this here show than you can possibly shake a can of hairspray at. And before we cut to a commercial break, we're going to pay tribute to them. So sit down and watch this. But don't light a match.
I go out walking after midnight.
Women never had it easy in the early days of Music City. Even the great Patsy Cline could only get on the telly doing domestic chores. Coal miner's daughter Loretta Lynn was far from the pits.
Except for memories of a coal miner's daughter. In and out, see if it's just right when.
While today there's Shania Twain, young, sexy, and selling truckloads of CDs.
When I have a bad hair day.
But if you're seeking true grit country, anti-Shania's like Gillian Welsh have burnt the push-up bras and rediscovered the bluegrass era.
From the Alabama trucks, half of the cotton and a third of the corn. Get a handful of dust.
All very credible, but the hottest female act at the moment are the Spice Girls of country, multi-Grammy Award winners, the Dixie Chicks. Watch out, they'll be here soon.
Welcome back. You know, long before there was a boy named Sue, there was a father and son named Hank. Now, the good news for Hank Jr. was that he inherited most of his daddy's musical genius. Bad news was that he inherited just about everything else, too.
Say, hey, good looking, what you got cooking? How's about cooking something up with me? Say, hey.
They called him the Hillbilly Shakespeare, and thanks to his appearances on the Grand Ole Opry, Alabama's Hank Williams became country's first megastar and sex symbol.
Bonkers. Screaming did not start with Beatlemania. It started in the Ryman Auditorium with Hank.
When he would sing on the stage and talk, I think every individual in that audience thought that he was singing to them alone.
I can't help it if I'm
in my opinion, was one of the first people that had the gift of taking a pen and a piece of paper and sitting down and dictating the entire range of human emotions.
I try so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do. It's just some evil scheme.
Very seldom ever did Hank Williams ever put a two-syllable word even in the song.
The news is out all over town that you've been seen a-running round. Wow. Picture's painted.
Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart?
Hank took sincerity to its utmost limits, you know, and he's immortal because of the songs.
But there was a dark side to the genius. His first wife divorced him and the Grand Ole Opry sacked him as Hank single-handedly invented the rock and roll lifestyle.
Hank was not a drunk, he was an alcoholic. You know, when he couldn't take a drink and stop. In other words, he would just go on and drink till he knocked himself out.
And Hank Sr. lived it, you know, he wasn't making any of that stuff up. He had a very turbulent and troubled and short life, a short life of trouble.
I think it has something in common with Sid Vicious. You know, live fast, die young. and have a good-looking corpse. That kind of like, you know, there's a bit of the punk rocker in Hank.
Hank Williams, drug addict, alcoholic, and country's greatest songwriter, died drunk and drugged in the back of his Cadillac on New Year's Day 1953. He was 29. Thousands flocked to his funeral in Alabama, but it wasn't the end. His memory lived on as the first Mrs. Williams put her son on the stage.
Your cheating heart will make you weep. You'll cry and cry and try.
His mother dressed him in gold LeMay outfits like Elvis, you know. And but she wanted him to sing straight country with the rock and roll look. That was her idea.
Your cheating heart will tell on you.
It's bad enough having to live up to someone who was ordinary, but having to live up to a something like Hank Williams. You know.
It couldn't be more different. Have DNA tests been done?
For I walked out on heaven when I walked out on you.
As it turned out, Hank Jr. was too much like his daddy. The usual country cocktail, fame, pills and booze, looked set to do for him too, until in 1975 he fell off a mountain.
And he slipped and he fell. And he fell 640 feet backwards down the mountain. His head hit a boulder and it split open just like a watermelon. And his brain popped out. And his eye popped out. Luck was on his side. God was there, of course. These two doctors had just come back from Vietnam. And they were specialties in head trauma cases. So they operated on him immediately. They knew what to do. I never thought he would ever sing again.
Incredibly, after 2 years reconstructive surgery, Hank Jr. did come back and has since reconfirmed his status as one of the biggest stars in country. And he's even found a way to record with his dad.
Williams Jr. is probably one of the all-time greats in country music. So I think the Hank Williams legend will live on and on and on.
You're on my lonely mind.
All right, now this next act is about as far away from Hank Williams as you can get and still be country. But now listen, she might not exactly be a household name over there in Britain, but as far as United States sales are considered, there are only four names ahead of this one. You watch.
This is the best-selling female artist of all time. You know who she is. And Madge, she's number two. At three, Houston, no problem. Mariah Carey's at four. And this lady's number five. And you probably don't know who she is.
I couldn't name a single one of her records.
Maybe not, but she sold more than 40 million of them. That's more than Janet Jackson, Celine Dion, or Gloria Estefan. This is Reba McEntire, country's most successful female artist of all time. Brilliantly, Reba is also a real cowgirl. She grew up on a ranch in Oklahoma, and her dad was three-time world rodeo champion. In fact, it was her father who stopped Reba roping bulls for a living and got her into showbiz, suggesting his teenage daughter sing the national anthem at the world rodeo finals.
Well, he's old. Can you see by the dawn's early light?
A gentleman by the name of Red Steigall heard me sing the national anthem, heard something different. And 11 months later, I had my recording contract with PolyGram Mercury.
Reba enjoyed steadily building success, but once the video age arrived, there was no stopping her.
It's not too late, and you'll always have a place to come back to.
It went number one. It was my first gold record. It was my first video. And there it was, Whoever's in New England, on HBO, right after Aretha Franklin. I said, I have arrived, finally.
Why?
Reba, a natural actress, created her own little Hollywood. There was a bit of Busby Berkeley, some films about soldiers, watch out Goldie Hawn, Richard Gere, and Lawrence of Arabia. By 1986, Reba was country's new first lady, winning the coveted Entertainer of the Year award.
I'm not gonna cry, I'm gonna faint.
And I said, Daddy, when you won your first world championship, was it the best part of getting the trophy and the belt buckle and the saddle, or getting there? He said, oh, getting there. The payoff was each day. And at the end, it's like, well, what else can you do? Just go do it again.
Reba was bigger than her hair, but like most country success stories, there was tragedy just around the corner.
San Diego officials say the plane carried 10 people, seven members of country singer Reba McEntire's band, her tour manager, the pilot and co-pilot.
Reba had lost almost her entire band. Less than a fortnight later, though, she was back on stage.
This is going to be a hard song to sing tonight. I've just said goodbye to some of my best friends. They entertained us. I'll miss them. I know you will, too.
I got on stage. I forgot who was on in the audience.
Oh, I guess the world ain't gonna stop from my broken heart.
I had seven band members. I had a tour manager and two pilots I was singing to. Everybody else, it didn't really matter.
Does he love you? Like
Reba bounced back with a huge hit, but it was a controversial girl and girl number.
Reba, I don't think the people in it, out there in America want to hear two women screaming at each other about one of them having an affair with her husband. And she said, Tony Brown, you're wrong.
Does he love you?
You know, I'll listen to other people's ideas, I'll listen to how they want me to do things, and then finally I'll say, you know what, I don't like that. I would really rather do it this way. And they're like, well, you can't do it that way. And I say, well, we'll see. And then pretty soon they're gone. Not to say that if you go against what I say, you're fired. No, not at all. It's just that people have to work together and have the same dream to make that dream come true.
For Reba, there are no more bad hair days. Not only is she a country superstar, her own company, Starstruck Entertainment, is the most successful business on Nashville's music row. Although we might not have caught on just yet, it's only a matter of time.
She's now ready to take the world on, and so I think she can conquer it. I mean, she's done everything else.
Oh, that's nice to know. Well, the secret's out.
Now, y'all may not be too familiar with Reba McEntire over there in Great Britain, but everybody knows this next guy. Unfortunately for him, that includes the tax man.
Well, I grew up in Abbott, Texas, a little farm and ranch community in central Texas. I grew up working on those farms and ranches. Well, when I was around 4 or 5, I was writing poems. And then when I learned to play guitar a little bit, I started putting melodies to those poems.
From the family Bible.
Willie Nelson had a tough childhood. Born into Depression-era America, his parents separated when he was 6 months old, and little Willie was brought up by his gran and granddad. By his mid-teens, the musical prodigy was a traveling songwriter looking for a break.
Willie
is the greatest underdog story, because he was truly one of those guys that never got a break except for he had to sell his songs and give them away and take, you know, pennies for them just to exist around here.
I think I was asking, I don't know, $10 a piece or something.
This man wrote Nightlife, Funny How Time Slips Away, Crazy, all in the same week.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely. I'm crazy, crazy for feeling so blue.
I went out to Patsy's house. I wouldn't get out of the car. I was a little shy back then, and I didn't want to be there if she didn't like the song. But she liked it.
Hello, Waltz. How'd things go for you today?
A lot of people like the young Liberace lookalike, but in 60s Nashville, Willie's chances to perform his own songs were few and far between. And I'll bet
you dress. I think my singing style was a little different than what I didn't really fit into a slot. They had their way of doing things there, and it was working for them. They had a formula. But if you try to buck that, you're in trouble from the beginning, you know, so.
Willie is such a free spirit musically, but he tried to do it the Nashville way. And he eventually, you know, just gave it up and said, I'm not going through this, I'm going back to Texas.
And he lay there in silence, too much on his mind.
Willie grew his hair, went back to basics, still and scared the pants off his record company.
Right.
So I wrote the Redheaded Stranger album, recorded it, and handed it to them, and they were in shock for a while because it was a little sparse.
Love is like a dying ember.
First time I heard that record, I was scratching my head going, this is kind of strange sounding. I mean, it's so raw, I don't think this is going to work. It worked really big. It changed music. I mean, it started a whole new movement.
The next step was to team up with fellow country rebel Waylon Jennings. Together, the so-called Outlaws took country to a whole new audience of hippies and students.
I look out there and all these little long-haired kids are out there. There ain't nobody in no cowboy hats and no cowboy suits out there. And I said, somebody go get that little red-headed son of a bitch. I said, he's got me in something. And so he called me back there and I said, Willie, what have you got me into this time? He said, trust me.
Well, I'm not really upset about the term outlaw. Really, I kind of like it. I think Waylon was a little upset with it because it was hitting a little too close to home.
You know, wonderful things came out of that. Of course, they smoked a lot of dope and drank a lot of whiskey and all that. I mean, there were people all over the country doing that. So it was kind of the rebels.
I thought it was a great way to sell records.
Although they sold millions, Willie didn't really want to be an outlaw. He wanted to be a crooner.
And the melody haunts my reverie. And I am once again with you.
They told me that in so many words that I was a little insane to think, you know, that these old songs would ever sell again.
That was long ago.
The record company was wrong again. Willie's collection of classic covers stayed in the album charts for 10 years.
Of a song.
Doing an album like Stardust was, you know, an unbelievable thing to do in country music. I mean, you know, country people don't sing pop standards, but Willie Nelson does.
We dedicate the song to all the girls we've loved before. To all the girls we've loved before. We travel in and out of doors.
And I thought I'd discovered it. You know, come to find out he'd already sold 100 million albums.
Over the past decade, Willie's become country's Bob Geldof, supporting middle America's rural poor with his regular Farm Aid concerts. He's also had to set up Willie Aid after receiving a multi-million dollar tax bill.
thought I owed them a lot more money than I thought I owed them.
I patched up your broken wing and hung around a while.
The reported figure was $16 million. Typically, Willie paid off the Inland Revenue Service by recording an album for them. And your fever
down. They were really cooperative. We did the IRS tapes together that raised some money. We went in business together.
Willie has been through so much money. And you know what? It doesn't seem to affect him. I mean, when the IRS came down on top of him, he didn't crawl in a hole. He just kept going. And he's back again. This guy has 9 lives.
Crazy for trying, crazy for crying, and I'm crazy for loving you.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad to see all those obstacles out there, you know? What's a good soldier do without a war?
You know, rock and roll likes to think they invented hellraising. But like we've been showing you with Willie Nelson, Johnny Cash, and the Williams family, country got there first, like they usually do. And the list doesn't just end with those guys. We're going to go to the break now with a list of country's most wanted.
The Outlaws, hard-living, hard-drinking rebels who rejected the slick Nashville sound of the late 60s and early 70s to take country back to its roots.
Someone called us outlaws in some old magazine. New York set a posse down like I ain't never seen. We don't let our old hair grow too long or too shaggy. Like the hippies out in San Francisco do it. Still do. And I'm proud to be a Loki from Muskogee, yeah. Just another holy man tried to make a stand. My God, they killed him.
And I'm just one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind.
From the crossroads of my doorstep, my eyes, they begin to fade.
And again, and again, and again, and
again. Hey, Kathy, whoop. I'm sorry I'm late, but I had to change the tire on the General Lee's. It brought to mind a song. You picked a fine time to leave me loose, wheel. Yeah, loose. Come on, that's my best joke.
No,
besides, it helps our friends over there in Britain to understand who number two is. You'll understand. Watch.
In a bar in Toledo, across from the depot, the bar stool, she took off the veil.
Kenny is a phenomenon.
When the drinks finally hit her, she said, I'm no quitter.
In Timbuktu, I was offered Kenny Rogers cassettes.
And he turned to the woman and said...
The only place where I've not heard Kenny Rogers is in North Korea.
You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucy. With 400 children and a crop in the field. I've had some bad times, lived through some sad times, but this time you're hurting, won't heal. You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille.
Okay, sing it with us.
Possibly the real role of the CIA is to make the world safe for Kenny Rogers.
The CIA might have been interested in Kenny's earlier incarnation. He had long hair, earrings, and sang about acid.
And Jimi Hendrix came in one night and sat at the bar, sat through two shows, and he told us that his favorite song of all time was Just Dropped In to See What Condition My Condition Was In.
I watched myself crawling up as I was crawling.
Country music is about people and about people's problems. And every person has a story, and every story is potentially a song, and that's really how country music derives. It derives from a pain that I hear about or I personally feel.
It wasn't me that started that whole crazy Asian war. I was proud to go and do my patriotic chore.
The first country smash came with the story of a Korean War casualty's fear of cuckoldry.
That I'm not the man I used to be.
No other form of music is going to have a song about a bloke who's lost his legs and is worried that because he's not got any legs anymore, he's going to be able to handle, you know, hold on to his girlfriend. Or is she going to go off to town and shag somebody else who's got legs?
Sakes, turn around.
It was a song that really, while on its face, was very morbid, but it was a real dichotomy, because if you listen to it, it's a very fun kind of a rhythm track.
It's hard to love a man whose legs are bent and paralyzed. I'm watching the needs of a woman your age, maybe I realize. But it won't be long, I've heard them say, until I'm not around. Oh, Ruby, don't take your love to town. For goodness sakes, turn around.
I've always been drawn to songs that tell stories, that start somewhere, say something, hopefully have a surprise. They're like mini movies to me.
Now it won't mean you're weak if you turn the other cheek. I hope you're old enough to understand. Son, you don't have to fight to be a man. There's someone for everyone. Tommy's love was
told in 3D Kenny vision, those stories were an international smash, but the super smooth Silver Stud had his eye on another audience.
Songs that were really kind of female oriented, and I thought, that's the market I want to get.
Lady, I'm your knight in shining armor, and I love you. You have made me what I am. I
guess he's probably was the most successful mass appeal country artist that we ever had. And actually, he was the pop artist who came to Nashville. And I don't think any other pop artist has ever done that at the level he did it.
You got the kind of body that was made to give a man a lot of pleasure.
Kenny's surname had become a verb, and the housewife's choice was also the preferred partner in a series of high-profile smash hit duets.
Don't fall in love with that dreamer, cause he'll break you every time. Items in the stream, that is what we are, no one in between. How can we be wrong?
Despite his professional success with the ladies, life on the road took its toll on his home life as four wives came and went.
I'm not talking about temptations of the road. I'm talking about the separation factor. This concept of absence makes the heart grow fonder just is not true.
Today, Kenny is happily married to wife number five, who, handily enough, has a twin sister. The bearded love machine is also into photographs and has become the smoothest celebrity snapper in the West.
And it brings me the same satisfaction, the same passion that music does. Now, if I never took another picture, it wouldn't be the end of the world. If I never sang another song, it would really bother me.
And yes, oh yes, I'll always want you near me. I've waited for you for so long.
I think every woman envisions marrying Kenny Rogers.
You're my lady.
All right, we're down to our final act, the act at number one. But before we tell you who that is, we're going to keep you in suspense by recapping the other nine great artists in our top ten.
Standing by at TEN, Tammy. Campbell's souped up at 9. In the Black with Cash at 8. At 7, Little John Denver. The Milky Bars are on him. Dolly has six appeal, Thanks for the Memories at five, Arriba at four, at three, country's very own Lord Nelson, and Silver Dream Machine Kenny Rogers is our first runner-up.
You know, there's some incredible stories in there.
And you know what's incredible about this next story?
What?
Nothing.
Nothing.
No brushes with the law, no years of struggle, nada.
And that's what's incredible about it. No, I'm not kidding. It's the biggest success story in country music.
And yeah?
It's going to be the biggest success story in music history, period.
Well, I guess that's why this guy is number one.
That's right.
Yeah,
absolutely.
The look in his eyes that I had seen in very few people's entertainers' eyes. It was like, wow.
He has made country music bigger than it has ever been.
I think all of us in Nashville wonder why he's so huge.
Garth Brooks, an incredible performer, an incredible story. Son of 50s country star Colleen Brooks, Garth left Oklahoma and followed his mum to Nashville in the late 80s. A little over a decade later, this former javelin thrower, bouncer and boot salesman is the world's biggest musical superstar, and he's country. In just 10 years, he sold 90 million albums in the States alone.
You take care of the music, and the dollars are going to take care of themselves. The record sales are going to take care of themselves, and the people are going to take care of themselves.
Cause I got friends in low places where the whiskey drowns and the beer chases my blues away.
Garth soon had friends in high places. Instead of the usual struggle, he had a record deal within a year of arriving in Nashville, although country's brightest new talent still drew on the good old storytelling tradition.
What Garth Brooks is, or what country music is, or Garth's music is to me, is the news put to music. It's just real life put to music. And even though maybe it's stories that haven't happened, a lot of times could be just the story hasn't happened yet.
Glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go.
I don't know, it's just much rather talk about things that are real. Instead of, you know, he tipped his Stetson as he two-stepped across a sawdust floor. That's just name-dropping is what it is.
The dance.
Garth Brooks.
Garth blew Nashville apart. In 1990, he was named country's best newcomer. He was soon country's biggest star. Within 2 years, he hit the top of the charts no less than five times, and the awards just kept coming and coming.
And the award goes to, no fences, Garth Brooks.
Garth Brooks?
Garth Brooks.
Garth Brooks.
Garth Brooks.
This is an artist who has already outsold Elvis Presley, the Supremes, the Beach Boys, I mean, every major act, pop act you can think of in America. I believe only the Beatles are still ahead of him in terms of worldwide record sales.
90 million he sold. It's unbelievable, isn't it?
I guess he strikes a chord.
Hello, Texas!
Some things are beyond our ken, aren't they? You know, it's like why.
And any time I doubt myself, I think of you. 'Cause it was your song that made me sing.
And yes, Garth Brooks is nice to his mum as well.
It was your voice that gave me wings.
Not only are his album sales going through the roof, so are the concert attendances, consistently overtaking records set by the likes of Elvis Presley and Elton John. Hell, Garth's even selling out huge gigs on this side of the water.
We all came here for party tonight.
Hollywood portrays country music and its listeners as being very ignorant, very slow, very racist, very backward. So I was coming over here with my fist clenched. And instead, I got an open arm and a hug.
Yeah!
And even New York gave Garth a cuddle. Nearly 1 million people turned out for his free concert in Central Park as country conquered one of the toughest cities on earth.
I really found it to be an electrifying moment, and in that moment I thought, this guy has changed country music forever.
So it's Stetson's off to Garth, a nice bloke, a marketing graduate, a one-man corporation, and closing in on the Beatles as the biggest selling artist of all time. Watch out, John Paul, George and Ringo.
Well, listen, it's been great. We've had a great time spending time with you. We'll do it again sometime.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got something really special to finish all this up with.
And you know, country music is a lot about heartbreak, but remember, wherever there's a D-I-V-O-R-C-E, there's also a W-E-D-D-I-N-G.
So we are going to play out with the ultimate country song. This is Nashville's first couple, Tammy and George, with a song about their wedding vows called Ceremony.
Now, of course, the marriage didn't last, but that's another song altogether, right, guys?
That sure is.
Hey, we're going to get a ticket here. We got to go.
We'll see you later.
Do you, Tammy, take this man, George, to be your lawfully wedded husband? And do you, George, take this woman, Tammy, to be your lawfully wedded wife, to love and to cherish until death do you part? Or better, or worse, you'll always come first, and no one can keep us apart. Yes, we take each other, forsaking our lovers, together till death. Now pronounce you man and wife.